while. So it's going to be quite extraordinary, but I make you laugh on it, and then I show you something to do with death. So yeah, a bit of a swerve. Anybody ever read a book called Run, Fat Bitch, Run? Women in the room, men never get fat, so you never have to read those books. Her name is Ruth Fields, and I was on News Talk one morning, and she followed it up with a book called Get Your Shit Together. That was the name of the book, though I'm not pressing it. So my editor, Garrett, said, Laura, 8:20 in the morning, you're going to interview Ruth. If you say shit on there, I will murder you. The kids are in the car, they're going to school, you just don't use that word in there. I said, okay, fine. Ruth comes on the phone, I said, great, Ruth, follow-up title to Run, Fat Bitch, Run. Great, get your act together. No, Laura, get your shit together. I said, yeah, see Ruth, the kids are in the car, it's 8:20, school going time. She said, yeah, let's get your shit together. She mentioned it, shit in 15 times, and I asked my second question. Well, Garrett was murdering me in my ear, saying, don't let her say that again. So I only say that because I'm not a poster girl for brief bereavement. Everybody here is going to have a certain amount of shit in their life. Sorry to use the phrase, I only told the story so I'd legitimize my ability to say that. So as you go through your life, you're going to lose your grandparents, you're going to lose your parents, you're going to lose your siblings, you're going to lose your friends. My friends is they're taking them off my shelf now. Those unfortunate enough may lose, you know, their children. So adversity is part of what makes life. Adversity is something that's going to happen to you whether you like it or not, but the question you have to ask yourself first and foremost is what happens when it does? So I'm no different, no poster girl. My sister died a few months before my husband did, my father died, good friends. However, nothing quite prepared me for the fact that the person that I considered to be the other half of myself was going to leave my life so suddenly. So like almost everybody else, on New Year's Eve, you know, when you sit over a bottle of wine and describe your new chapter. So he's a young boy, and business is in 2004. I had all sorts of plans. We did a chapter that we had decided we were going to live. So it's hilarious that somebody who spent their life studying strategy, I did Ashridge Management College for 2 years, followed it up with advanced strategic management. So it was a big lesson for me to know that life has other plans here sometimes. And when Richard was diagnosed with cancer and we went through that roller coaster for 4 months, myself and Darren, my boy, were totally unprepared for the fact that in his 40s he was going to leave us. So suddenly, so graphically, I think being a nurse, I was a nurse to start with, you would imagine that I would have been prepared and I'd understand that. But by the time we got to Black Rock Hospice, I remember the nurse telling me all the time, you know, your husband's very ill. And I was looking at him saying, do you think I'm crazy? She has cancer in most of his organs. But what she was trying to tell me is he was just about to die. I didn't understand that, I didn't get it until that moment when my brave son asked the doctor, is my dad going to die? And that's how myself and Richard and him discovered that he was about to die within the next 24 hours as it happened. So it created a degree of honesty, which I'm always grateful for. But bear in mind that in my life I was a dragon. I had a persona of a tough businesswoman, great in negotiations, not so good at feeling vulnerable. So I'm going to tell you something very honest, because I want to encourage you to be honest as those back and to think about your life. I don't want you to go through what I go through to get kicking the arse to do something slightly different. So the honest truth is, when Richard left, I didn't really know what to do. I couldn't climb under the bed. I have a 12-year-old son. I needed to introduce structure. I have a good friend who lost her husband 2 years beforehand. She walks to the grave every morning, and that's 5 years ago. She still walks to the grave every morning. I see women and men who live a kind of a shadow life when they lose the person they love the most, and they cannot continue to live their lives. So for me, I went back into my business, my main business. I had 11 businesses at the time. My main business is publishing. And the publishing business requires you to be energized all of the time. You don't walk in and slide into your office and look at the computer. You go in and you spark up all the editors, you brainstorm with the sales team, you sit with the designers. So most of you know that. You're the best ambassador for your business. Part of what I'm trying to say to you today is it's not just staff. Your staff might be brilliant, but if you're on an off day, if you're in an off moment in your life, you're not going to be good for your business. And I wasn't good for Harmonia. I was going in every day, I didn't want to see people, I didn't want to talk to people, I certainly didn't want to give anybody any energy. All the things I loved about my life, which was growing somebody else's talent. You know, at some point in your life, you start to mentor people and you get a real kick out of the fact that somebody does something brilliant and you created that. I didn't want to do that anymore. I didn't have enough energy for myself. I didn't want to be the person at the center of the boardroom. So after about 6 months, Marion Finucane asked to interview me. And I kind of knew in my heart that she was going to ask me about Richard, because she used to work with Richard. Richard worked for the BBC. But I kind of denied it too. I thought she said it's a profile interview. So sat in the studio, she asked me about growing up in Phoenix Park and being a nurse and a journalist and moving into management and buying businesses. And everything was going swimmingly until about 20 minutes in, and she said, can we talk about Richard? Now, I can talk to you now about Richard without, you know, going back in my mind, I suppose. But at the time, time I couldn't. It was the first time anybody had asked me on air anything about that moment. And in my head, I went right back to the hospice, to him dying. And Marion, she was a professional. She was asking me questions. She was trying to find out how it felt. But I actually ended up with a big lump in my throat, unable to speak, and I started crying. I was beyond mortified. I cannot tell you how destroyed I was.